Hemoptysis, thoracic masterclass. It is estimated that 5 to 14% of patients presenting with hemoptysis will have life-threatening hemoptysis, with a reported mortality rate between 9 and 38%. This lecture provides a comprehensive literature review on life-threatening hemoptysis, including the etiology and mechanisms, initial stabilization, and management of patients.
Hemoptysis is defined as coughing up of blood or blood-tinged sputum. It may originate at the level of larynx, trachea, bronchi, or lung parenchyma. Classification: it depends on the amount of blood loss within 24 hours, and hence can be classified into mild was less than 30 cm raised to the power of 3 per 24 hours, moderate between 30 and 50, severe, subdivided into massive with 600 cm raised to the power of 3 per 24 hours, and torrential with 150 cm cubes per hour.
Causes of hemoptysis: inflammatory and infections, such as tuberculosis, fungal ball, lung abscess, cystic fibrosis, vascular, and this could be due to pulmonary embolism, pulmonary infarction, pulmonary aneurysm, pulmonary arteriovenous malformation. Vasculitis, and this could be due to acute lung allograft rejection, and to phospholipid syndrome, Besnet disease, Goodpasture syndrome, Henoch-Schönlein purpurin, isolated pulmonary capillaritis, Wegener granulomatosis, cardiac, and this could be due to mitral stenosis, neoplastic, and this could be due to primary or secondary lung cancer, adenoma, miscellaneous, and this could be due to lymphangeal leiomyomatosis, catamenial, pneumoconiosis, bronchiolitis, and lastly, iatrogenic, and this could be due to biopsy, Swan-Ganz catheter. Clinical presentation: blood-streaked sputum, clotted blood, or frank fresh red blood. They should be differentiate from hematemesis, which shows dark blood, associated with nausea, and or vomiting, acidic, and no froth. Classification to determine the amount has been previously mentioned.
Investigations, and this includes complete blood count, coagulation profile, ABA group. Investigation is directed to the cause, such as tuberculin tests, sputum culture, chest X-ray, high-resolution CT scan, pulmonary bronchial and pulmonary artery angiography, indirect laryngoscopy, and bronchoscopy for diagnosis, localization, and therapeutic. Chest X-ray identified the bleeding site in 46% of life-threatening hemoptysis cases, and the underlying bleeding cause only in 35%.
CT is superior to chest X-ray for detecting the site of bleeding in life-threatening hemoptysis, with correct localization in 70 to 88.5% of cases. Imaging techniques, however, may not permit the localization of the bleeding site in patients with pre-existing bilateral lung disease and or aspiration of blood into non-bleeding segments. CT is superior to chest X-ray for detecting the site of bleeding in life-threatening hemoptysis, with correct localization in 70 to 88.5% of cases. Imaging techniques, however, may not permit the localization of the bleeding site in patients with pre-existing bilateral lung disease and or aspiration of blood into non-bleeding segments.
While CT appears to have the highest diagnostic yield for life-threatening hemoptysis, fiberoptic bronchoscopy remains invaluable for patients needing airway control and in patients with bilateral lung disease. In some cases, the combination of bronchoscopy and CT may be more effective than either alone.
Angiography is potentially both diagnostic and therapeutic. Following initial stabilization and localization of the bleeding site, first-line therapy for life-threatening hemoptysis is usually bronchial artery embolization.
The algorithm of management of hemoptysis: this depends on the amount of bleeding at the time of presentation, mild hemop to warrant a time frame to search for the underlying cause, direct disease-specific treatment, if infection give 2 weeks of antibiotics, before ordering CT scan, and bronchoscopies. However, a scan on the bronchoscopy are indicated in this case is when persistent symptoms for more than 2 weeks, recurrence, smokers, and above 40 years of age, and if the amount increases, patient who presents with a moderate symptoms should be admitted to the hospital. Hematocrit monitoring, chest scan, and bronchoscopy. In life threatening condition, the initial step should be resuscitation, stopping bleeding, prevention of asphyxiation, followed by definitive management, and this could be achieved by interventional conservative management or surgical interference. life-threatening hemoptysis, the initial management, and conservative treatment. In this situation, intensive care admission, applying the ABC, and volume resuscitation protocol, with wide-bore intravenous access and oxygen supplementation. If the side of bleeding is known, patient to take the bleeding side down. However, if in semi-setting, decubitus should be adopted. Intravenous antibiotics, together with intravenous tranexamic acid, octreotide, and vasopressin, should the patient become stable, a high-resolution CT scan, and bronchoscopy should be done. Life-threatening hemoptysis interventions. This can be achieved utilizing rigid bronchoscopy, bronchial artery embolization, and radiotherapy. Rigid bronchoscopy in these circumstances can be diagnostic, localize the site of bleeding, and therapeutic. Using ice-cold saline with epinephrine has saved many patients by stopping bleeding. Blockers at the segmental, lobar, or main stem bronchus can be placed through rigid bronchoscopy. The findings at angiography include enlarged or tortuous arteries, active contrast extravasation, and hypervascularity. These findings are more common in bleeding due to chronic lung inflammation compared with malignancies. Pulmonary artery angiography is sometimes performed to assess for pulmonary artery abnormalities such as Erasmussen aneurysm. The most common complication is self-limited chest pain, which occurs in 1.4 to 34.5% of patients. Transient dysphagia may occur in up to 30% of procedures as a result of esophageal non-target embolization. Recurrence is expected with fungal ball, sarcoidosis, and TB. The most serious complication is unintended spinal artery embolization leading to transient or persistent periparesis or paraplegia. Recurrence of bleeding within 2 weeks after bronchial artery embolization is usually due to incomplete embolization, due to lack of a complete search of all offending vessels, or inability to embolize all arteries, including the non-bronchial systemic artery collaterals. The second peak for recurrence of bleeding is from 1 to 2 years after the initial.
Emergent lung resection for life-threatening hemoptysis had a reported mortality rate of 40%, compared with an 18% mortality rate when performed electively. The exception is only for chest trauma, arteriovenous malformations, tracheobronchial fistula, and fungal ball. Video-assisted thoracoscopy, or conventional thoracotomies may be utilized. The section may vary from wedge, segmental, lobar, or even pneumonectomy. The role of endoscopic laser. Cryotherapy may only be indicated in localized bleeding from tumors, granulation tissues, or bleeding mucosa.
Summary of management. The first step is to stabilize the patient hemodynamics, bronchial artery embolization, reevaluation for surgical resection for definitive treatment, and prevention of recurrence.